within the peloton, not super concerned at this point about the position or the composition of that breakaway, but the concentration now is all around their positioning towards the front as they go to the base of the climb.
Well, it would have been a bit of a lead out coming in. You could see that chicane there over the bridge. Positioning is not as important in this race as it is in some of the cobbled classic, but they still want to be near the front. They want to be maximizing their abilities. And I'm also interested to see what this group of four does. I'm still looking at Amanda Spratt in particular and Rooster to really split this group of four up and get as much advantage over the top as they can. I'm feeling like this is a little bit of a replay of last year in Rooster being the last one out of the breakaway to be cresting the climb. She's waiting for the likes of Annemiek van Vleuten, but hopefully her teammate in Vollering to jump across to her. This is exactly what she did last year to put herself in great position to be in that front group in the last 30 kilometres of the race.
She has not looked to her breakaway companions for support because they're not capable of sticking with her. Spratt loses contact as Rusa is free to fly on her own. She'll take some catching.
In the minds of the Trek Segafredo team and, of course, in Canyon SRAM as well, absolutely motivated to bring this rider back.
And the pace of Spratt at the front has caused a small split within the peloton. Spratt has been sensational.
She really has. She's done a super job today. Also in the breakaway, also alone, trying to chase Rusa, and now doing a superb job on the front. She's showing us how strong she is.
She's got our Vollering there behind her and see if they can make a bridge back up to this second group of three.
Longo Borghini. She's had her teammates do the work. Van Anroy, one last gasp and a good luck to Longo Borghini, who is on the charge and not looking across her shoulder for Chabet to assist with the pacemaking.
Well, about a tailwind up a climb is actually plays into the favour of sometimes those heavier riders. If you're a climbing specialist, you actually want the climb to be hard and headwind. But now Vollering has bridged across to the wheel of Elise Chabet. So these are the riders in second, third and fourth on the road.
And Van Vleuten has not given up the fight. Just in the distance.
But look at this difference here. We've got a woman who's been in the breakaway all day looking finally a little fatigued. Her superstar teammate Demi Vollering is now bridging across, and the world champion and two-time winner is desperately clawing her way onto the wheel of Elise Chabet. Rusa will now go into domestique mode, absolutely, and try and do the work to keep putting Van Vleuten under pressure. Look at her head swaying from side to side in fatigue.
Oh, she's worth a picture in the Macquarie Dictionary for the definition of determination. She has fought her way back into contention. And as we say that, she has sensed a moment of weakness in Van Vleuten, and Vollering is going across on her own.
Well, they could see them in the distance. It was only 17 seconds on this climb, which means that you get your hope up. And now to have Vollering bridging across, that's not good news for Elisa Longo Borghini. She will have to chase any counter move by Vollering and get on that wheel.
It's exactly what she does. Slots into the slipstream of Vollering. Now, Raiolini looks across the shoulder, number 54 from Trek Segafredo. It's not her responsibility to do the chasing. Marlene Ruser cannot respond to the increase of the tempo by her teammate Vollering.
It's going to be very hard for those riders to make up 24 seconds in just 3.5 kilometres when they're travelling at such high speeds.
At these speeds, the only opportunity for the chasing group to get back is if out in front they make a mistake.
Isn't it two riders looking over their shoulder, waiting to see when the other one is going to jump? But in this instance, they also have five riders about 15 seconds behind them.
300 metres to go. They're down to the 200 metre marker. They haven't opened up yet. Longo Borghini is delaying for as long as possible. Now she goes. That's her bid for victory. Can Vollering get back over the top of her? Vollering is on her way. Longo Borghini slips back in a second. It's Vollering who's victorious again. She gets the triple. Amstel Gold Race, Flèche Wallonne and Bastogne Liège. The race for third, it's the world champion Annemiek van Vleuten showing all her class, fighting through to the finish. But it's Marlene Rooser who is coming over the top to collect third. She's been in the break all day long and she gets onto the podium.
And once her head's down, then she can see her wheels in front of Longo Borghini. She starts to look up, and this is the moment she can't believe it. Shakes her head there like, I cannot believe this. Victory, incredible.
But everybody else believes it. Puts up the three fingers. She's got the hat trick.
Amstel Gold Race, La Flèche, and now Liège. What's the feeling? You made history again. Oh, it's amazing. I cannot believe it. I'm so grateful for my teammates and super proud.
Équipe SD Works, Demi Vollering. You can still see the emotion in her face. She knows that she's creating her own piece of history. This is her fifth win for the season, and it is the most significant because it rounds out the Ardennes triple. She's got herself the hat trick. She is the winner of Liège-Bastogne-Liège.